Where would our church be today without self-supporting ministry? We have Frank Fournier speaking today. He and his wife Jen are members of the Cashmere Church, I think, officially. Okay. And they're building a home just outside of Leavenworth. But Frank has been involved in self-supporting ministry for many, many years. And was president of Eden Valley. Is that Colorado? Yes, okay. You know, there's all kinds of wonderful self-supporting ministries. Wienmeyer, Beach Pines. Some of those have a health focus. But also, Janet was involved in an orphanage in Tanzania. Was it Tanzania? Okay. And so Frank has been, and his wife and his family, which you've been to Cashmere, you know Steve and Angela Ford, Angela being their daughter. But they've been involved in advancing the claims of God's kingdom for many, many years. And Dorothy and I have had an opportunity to sit in as Frank's given some weeks of prayer in the Cashmere Church. And I've been blessed, and I know we'll be blessed by his words.
Friendly? True. We're happy to be here. Thank you for the invitation. I don't need to say this, I guess, but I feel a little insecure. It's the first time I grow a beard. It's going to be 75 in a month and a half, and I've never grown one of those things. Is it ever itchy? I think it'll be the last time. In any case, I'm involved in Journey to Bethlehem, and I agreed that I would do that. And so I am. I'd like to invite you to turn with me to 1 Corinthians chapter 4. 1 Corinthians chapter 4. You'll notice in your bulletin the title for this morning's message, Introspection. I suppose you know what introspection is. According to the dictionary, it's looking inward. Some people are very introspective. Some people are not introspective enough. It's not a matter of right or wrong, I think, in this thing, but it's something that human nature does, and this is what I want to talk about. As a matter of fact, this sermon is aimed at people who go around wondering what their contribution to the Lord has been. Has it been worth anything? The Apostle Paul here is speaking. We're in 1 Corinthians chapter 4, and we're looking at verse 3. But with me it is a very small thing that I should be judged of you as of man's judgment. In other words, he's saying, that I don't really care what you think about me. Now, he's got a reason for saying this. The rest of the verse says it's because that I can find it. Yea, I judge not my own self. Why? For I know nothing by myself. Now, if I know nothing by myself about myself, what is it you know about me? You know you're less, right? If you know nothing about yourself, by yourself, what is it that I know about you? So how is it that people can be so quick to judge you, or you so quick to judge someone else, when we don't even know anything about ourselves by ourselves? And this is what the Apostle Paul is really trying to say here. Okay. I'll have you turn to Jeremiah chapter 17. Now you know probably instinctively, at least some of you will know instinctively where I'm going. This is Jeremiah chapter 17, and we're looking at verse 9. The heart is deceitful above all things and desperately wicked. Who can know it? What's implied in the question, who can know it? Nobody knows, right? Well, we know that God knows it, verse 10. I, the Lord, search the hearts and try the brain through the emotions, even to give every man according to his ways and according to the fruit of his doing. So if we're going to know anything about ourselves, then God's going to have to reveal, right? And I think there's a lot about ourselves that we don't know. Well, we know that. We've been grown, especially as Christians in the Christian church, to understand that the Lord is growing us. And there's a lot about ourselves that we don't know, and He does. Now, the Apostle Paul didn't care what you thought about him because he figured it'd be wrong anyway. You really don't know him. That's what he's saying.
Amen.
But he did say some things about himself, and I want to go there. Go with me to 1 Timothy chapter 1. 1 Timothy. By the way, I preached this in Valley View not very long ago. If you happen to be from Valley View and you were there, I apologize, because you're going to hear it again. So we're in 1 Timothy, and we're in chapter 1, verse 15. The Apostle Paul talking about himself. This is a faithful saying and worthy of all acceptation, that Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners. Now, up until this point, praise the Lord.
Amen.
Worthy of acceptation. Jesus went to the cross in an effort to save as many people as he can save in this world. But the rest of the verse says, and this is where Paul is speaking of himself, of whom I am chief. Now you would wonder, as the Apostle Paul being the greatest apostle in the New Testament, he wrote nearly half of it, and here he calls himself the chief of sinners. Why would he say that about himself? Well, put yourself in his shoes. He was, before he became a Christian, he was instrumental in hunting down Christians, putting them in prison, putting them to death, and he was there helping to put Stephen to death as well. So he probably really felt guilty about all of that. He saw himself as a great sinner. How do you see yourself? Go with me to Ephesians chapter 3. Ephesians chapter 3, this is still the Apostle Paul, and he's got a little insight into himself here as well. This is Ephesians chapter 3. We're looking at verse 8. Unto me, who am less than the least of all saints, is this grace given, that I should preach among the Gentiles the unsearchable riches of Christ. He saw himself as less than the least of all saints, and yet, in spite of being less than the least of all saints, he was still given this amazing responsibility, and the Lord used him mightily. So the question at this point is, was the Apostle Paul just being humble here, or did God reveal to him these things that he said about himself? Did it come by inspiration? Moses, go with me to Numbers chapter 12. We're going to Numbers chapter 12, and we're looking at verse 3 in Moses. Now, if I put my glasses on and off and on and off, it's because I can't see my Bible without my glasses. I can't see my notes with my glasses. This happens when you get a certain age. Wait for it. It's coming. So we're in Numbers chapter 3, excuse me, it's Numbers chapter 12, verse 3. Numbers chapter 12, verse 3. Now the man Moses was very meek above all the men which were upon the face of the earth. If Moses was very meek, more meek than any man upon the earth, do you think he would write something like this about himself? Why, no. If he was really humble, he wouldn't write like that about himself. So why did he write that about himself? Well, because he was writing by inspiration. God was behind this. He wanted you and I to know who Moses was. And according to God, this is the meekest man that ever walked the face of the earth. I imagine that poor old Moses must have felt bad for writing that. So it's like, I really don't mean to brag, but I'm the meekest man on the earth. I have two views about myself. When I think about what God has done for me, I am overwhelmed with gratitude for what He has done. It's amazing. I grew up in a wonderful family. I was the eldest of 8 children. My father and mother were lovers. I never saw them fight. We didn't fight as children. It was a good home to grow up in. I grew up in a wonderfully free environment. It was in Northern Ontario in Canada, and we were by a lake, and there was mountains, little mountains, of course, in Ontario. They're not big mountains. They're little mountains over a mile away or so, and we were just free to roam. It didn't matter how old we were. It was not dangerous at that time. It was amazing. I wish children today had the same freedom that we had back then. I got married. My wife is right there. We've been married 53 years. We have 3 children. We have 12 grandchildren. We have 3 great granddaughters. What a blessing that is. I've had the privilege, and by the way, I really don't have any formal education. I finished grade 10. That's it. But I've never been unemployed, because at a certain point in time, I was employed at that time as well. I gave my heart to the Lord, and I've been working for the Lord for 48 years. I've had the privilege of preaching in 50 countries, the gospel. I am in good health. My heel hurts a little bit. Pastor Jim Anderson and I got injured the same war. We're still hurting. But I'm in good health. I have a great appetite, too good, actually. And I have more friends than I can count. And on top of all that, I have the assurance of salvation. Who can ask for more? What the Lord has done for me, I'll never be able to match. I'll never be able to be unhappy about, complain about, criticize at all. The Lord has been so good. But you know, every coin has 2 sides, right? And I said I had 2 views of myself. And that's the one view when I look at what God has done for me. Ah, but when I look at what I have done for God, my achievements in God's work, the great successes of my life, my influence, all of that, what do you think I see? Nothing. Not really. What have I done? What have I accomplished? I tell you. I got started thinking about that when I read a little quotation about Moses not very long ago. It's from the book Patriarchs and Prophets, page 471, paragraph 4. Now you understand, Moses has made a mistake, and he is going to die. He's on top of Mount Nebo. The Lord says, you're going to die. He's 120 years old. His strength is unabated. He would not have died naturally at that time, but the Lord put him to sleep. Okay, so there he is. I don't know how long he was on top of the mountain, having time to reflect on his life, but that's what he was doing. He was reflecting on the past in his life, and guess what? Patriarchs and Prophets 471, paragraph 4. As Moses reviewed the result of his labors, his life of trial and sacrifice seemed to have been almost in vain. Oh, wait a minute. Isn't Moses the greatest leader that the Lord has sent to this world? How could he look at his life and think, almost in vain? Isn't that amazing? Why would he think that way? Well, if you give it a little bit of thought, you might have some idea why he thought that way. Remember, he was raised of God to lead the children of Israel from Egypt to the land of Canaan, right? And he left with 2 million people out of Canaan. He made his way all the way out of Egypt. He made all the way to Canaan. And how many of the 2 million did he bring into Canaan?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. 0.
Well, 2. Well, he didn't bring them in, even. You're right. But 2 of the original 2 million made it into the land of Canaan. What a resounding success. But no, it wasn't. Right? 40 years later, he's back on the borders of Canaan. He stumbles and falls, and he mars his witness. And the Lord is not able, we talked about that in the Sabbath school lesson this morning, the Lord was not able to bring him into the land of Canaan. And so when he was slated to be translated, it turns out that he had to die before he would be translated. And so he looked at his life and thought, made a message. Isn't that amazing? Yeah. Well, if Moses felt that way about his own life, what am I supposed to think about my life? I didn't accomplish what Moses accomplished, that's for sure. And you can put yourself in God's shoes. God raised up Moses to do a certain work. Moses did the work. He really did. However the outcome, still in all, he was absolutely successful because his life was almost perfect. Almost perfect. And that's all that the Lord wanted from Moses, really. Just do what I ask you to do. The consequences, leave them up to me. Now, this is not a phenomenon. This is not an anomaly. This is Christian reality, you know? And that's why I'm sharing this with you this morning as best I can. This is reality as far as being a Christian, living a Christian life is all about. Talking about John the Baptist, I'm in the book Desire of Ages, page 216, paragraph 1. Watch this. Now, by the way, what did Jesus have to say about John the Baptist? The greatest man born of a woman. Isn't that what he said? The greatest man that ever lived. That's wonderful. Notice what John thought of himself. John, this is Desire of Ages 2:16. John had been bitterly disappointed in the result of his mission. To this mission, his whole life had been sacrificed. Then he asked himself the question, had it been in vain? The way he lived, separate from society, living in the desert, dressed in rough garments and eating locusts and honey. Yeah. Right? Locusts and honey. Carrot. Yeah. What do you think? Why would he think that way? And then why would Jesus call him the greatest man ever born of a woman? Well, you have to start backing up and start thinking how does God think anyway, right? When I look at my life, when John the Baptist looks at his life, when the Apostle Paul looks at his life, when Moses looks at his life, it's, did I live my life in vain? It seems like I failed in this world. So God must look at this a little differently than we do, don't you think? I would think it's that way, yeah. Do you know that that kind of thinking is the result of true conversion? You'll go with me to Ezekiel chapter 36. Ezekiel chapter 36. Now you know in Ezekiel 36 is one of the greatest promises that you could ever get. Ezekiel 36, we're looking at verse 26. God says, a new heart also will I give you, and a new spirit will I put within you. I will take away the stony heart out of your flesh, and I will give you a heart of flesh. Do you ever claim this promise? Do you ever ask God to give you a new spirit and a new heart so that you don't meet life the way you've been meeting it until this time? What a blessing it would be if we had a new heart, right? So that everything we said, everything we thought, everything we did was just the way Jesus would do it. Ah, it would feel so good. But notice what happens when God fulfills that promise to you. Verse 31. We're still in Ezekiel 36. We're looking at verse 31. When that promise is fulfilled to you, then shall ye remember your own evil ways and your doings that were not good, and shall loathe yourselves in your own sight for your iniquities and for your abominations. Isn't that amazing? That's what it says. When we are true Christians, we compare ourselves with Jesus. As a matter of fact, it's in the book Steps to Christ, page 64, that says, the closer we come to Jesus, the more faulty we will appear in our own eyes. Why? Because the closer you come to perfection, the more your imperfections are revealed, right? And how do you feel about that? Well, you don't feel necessarily very good about that. You might feel good if you understand the theology behind it, because it just happens to be that way. If you are wondering about your life of service to God and what you've accomplished and who you are you doing what God wants you to do, you might reflect that if you don't feel very good about it, it's a good thing. It's a good thing. Obviously, you're close enough to the Lord that the Holy Spirit is able to reach your hearts.
Amen.
But Christianity has a problem. I know that if you go to the book of Revelation, chapter 3, where there are seven churches, and the seventh church is God's true church at the end of time, or it's Christianity at the end of time, what is Christianity thinking in the Laodicean message? We are rich and increased with good and need of nothing. Really? How can we come to that conclusion? We're not close enough to Jesus. That's why we come to that conclusion. Do you know, maybe I should recite the whole word, the whole verse, right? We think or we see ourselves to be rich and increased with good and need of nothing, but we don't know that we are wretched and miserable and poor and blind and naked. And when we look at this verse, we tend to say, well, the lost are wretched and miserable and poor, blind and naked, and the saved are spiritually rich. But that's not what the verse is saying. The verse is saying that the lost don't know that they are poor, blind, and naked. So what do the saved know? This is exactly what happens. The closer we come to Jesus, the more our spiritual poverty, our spiritual blindness just comes to the fore. And we should be encouraged by that, I would think, anyway. But the problem, of course, is, according to the Bible, Christianity in the last days is deceived. They think everything's okay. And by the way, I hate to say this, but if you think you're really doing really, really good, friend, you're in trouble. No, it just happens to be that way. We are not really doing very good. As a matter of fact, the world should have been turned upside down a long time ago, don't you think? If the Holy Spirit had been poured out upon us the way it should have been, the whole world would have been lightened with the glory of God's character. This is promised. This is a prophecy that will be fulfilled. Revelation chapter 18, verse 1. It will be fulfilled when the 144,000 are sealed in their foreheads with the seal of the living God. But obviously we haven't been sealed with the seal of the living God. So maybe this morning we need to be a little bit more introspective. Are you impressed with your goodness? Are you impressed with all that you have accomplished in the Lord's work, your great successes? Or like Moses and Paul and John the Baptist and Job? By the way, Job, what did God have to say about Job? He was a perfect and an upright man. Who said that? God did. Did God know what he's saying? Does God lie? No. Job was a perfect and an upright man. Right? You remember how Job felt about himself at the end of his testing? If you go to the book of Job, I hear you reciting it. And it's true. Job chapter 42. This is at the end of the story when God finally appears to him, asks him a few hard questions like, where were you? Well, I created everything. Yeah. Verse 5 and 6. I've heard of thee by the hearing of the ear, but now mine eye seeth thee. Wherefore I abhor myself and repent in dust and ashes. He abhorred himself. That was a perfect and an upright man, according to God. He had a lot to abhor, I guess. So what does God really look for in you and I? Isaiah chapter 66. I sure hope you don't mind using your Bibles this morning, because I'm just going from one text to the other. Isaiah 66, we're looking at verse 2. And this is what God wants from you and from me. This is the person God looks for. Halfway through the verse there, the first half almost has little to do with the second half, where it starts with, but to this man will I look, even to him that is poor, that is feels his spiritual poverty, and of a contrite spirit, and trembles at my word. This is what God is looking for. People who feel their fallen condition. Do you know that we're all fallen? Do you know that we're all sinners? Do you know that we accomplish very little? Even our best righteousnesses, our best behaviors are filthy rags. We have nothing for which to boast. Nothing at all. Jesus brings us salvation through a gift that he gives to us outright. He just comes to you and me and says, here's the gift. You can have the gift of salvation for just being grateful. Just say thank you. And the gift is yours. Then we look at ourselves and we say, yeah, well, I don't deserve it, so maybe I ought to clean up my act. Well, we ought to clean up our act. We ought to be totally obedient to the Lord. We ought to be like Jesus was. This is what Jesus is waiting for, by the way. But we'll never be saved by focusing on obedience. We are saved through a wonderful gift of Christ's righteousness. In volume 7 of the testimony, page 271, it's a strange quotation, chapters 2 and 3. I don't read the whole thing, actually. Christ's heart is cheered by the sight of those who are poor in every sense of the term. Now, question, in how many ways can a person be poor? Well, when we talk about poverty, usually we're talking about money, right? Poor monetarily, but do you know you can be poor in intelligence, you can be poor in education, you can be poor in spirit, you can be poor talents, gifts. There's a thousand ways in which we can be poor. And Jesus is cheered when a person feels the sense of his poverty in everything. Well, wait a minute. Why would that cheer Jesus up? Because, friends, that's our reality. It's our reality. And all that this is saying is, Jesus is not cheered because I'm poor. He's cheered because I realize my poverty. And we are poor. I don't care how rich you are. You're not rich like Christ. I don't care how intelligent you are. You're not as intelligent as God, right? It doesn't matter. If we have to compare ourselves with God, we come out looking very bad. And at that point, when we realize our spiritual poverty, our physical poverty, our mental poverty, our every poverty, the Lord says, praise the Lord. From the soul that feels his need, nothing is withheld. Our great need is our only claim to God's mercies. How many other claims are there? None. Do you have a need? Our need is far greater than we realize, of course. And we ought to approach God with our need. When you get to heaven and the Lord asks you, why should I let you in here? Don't say, well, because I sacrificed so much for you. It's not going to work. We didn't sacrifice anything for him. He did all the sacrificing. We receive all the blessings. Psalms 109 is speaking about King David. Now, I'm pretty sure King David was wealthy. King David, according to the Bible, was very good looking. He was an amazing warrior. He was very intelligent. He had many more gifts than I'll ever have. There's no doubt about it. But I want you to hear his prayer. We're in Psalms 109, verse 21 and 22. But do thou for me, O Lord, O God the Lord, for thy name's sake, because thy mercy is good. Deliver thou me, for I am poor and needy. Now wait a minute. How poor and needy do you think King David was? But that's what he saw. I am poor and needy, and my heart is wounded within me. Well, he had some reasons, of course, to go there. And we have pretty well the same reason. Pretty well. I became a Bible believer when I was 27 years old, really 25 years old, but I became a Seventh-day Adventist when I was 27 years old. By the time I was 30, I was asked to be the president of a small self-supporting institution in South River, Ontario, in Canada. And I was president there for 5 years. Every year, of course, we'd have a board meeting, and every year there was a little delegation of my comrades. They would get together, they would come to me and they'd say, listen, you're a bad leader, you're a poor leader, and we've decided that you need to be replaced, so we're going to go to the board and we're going to suggest so-and-so be the leader in your stead. And I honestly said to them, they were my friends, they were right, and I honestly said to them, I sure hope you succeed. It would be a tremendous blessing to me. So much stress being in this position, you understand. But I said, there's a real problem. God asked me to be the president of this thing. What are you going to do? Go to the board. I hope you succeed. Right? Well, they didn't succeed, but I did resign my position after 5 years. So from there, I went to Foundview Academy, and I was a Bible teacher there for a couple of years. Then we went to Africa, and we were in the Sotho Some of you won't know where Lesotho is, but it's in Africa. It's a little country, landlocked in South Africa. We were in Lesotho for 2 years, and there I was teaching four villages, giving Bible studies in four villages for 2 whole years in a row. From there, I became the president of Riverside Farm Institute in Zambia. It's an amazing oasis, that place. Just fantastic what the Lord did. After that, I was the executive vice president of Outpost Centers International. Outpost Centers is a umbrella organization over, right now, 225 ministries, I guess, in 70 countries. Anyways, I was vice president for 10 years. And I was president of Eden Valley for 12 years. I was president of ASI for 4 years. And when I look at my life to see what I have accomplished for the Lord, nothing. It's terrible to be president of so many places and really achieve nothing. But I'm not sure that I've achieved nothing. I mean, I'm not sure that the Lord achieved nothing. It just reminds me of the story in the Bible of the widow with her two mites. You remember the widow with her two mites? Jesus is sitting by the temple treasury watching. That's what we're told in the Bible. And so these wealthy people come along and they're casting big lots of money into the treasury, making a big show of it so they can be seen of men as very generous and all the rest. Eventually there comes a little lady, she's a widow, doesn't say she's old, doesn't say she's young, it just says she has two mites, which is 25 cents in today's currency apparently. In any case, she went over to the treasury, she dropped her two little mites in, and tried to slink away because she felt embarrassed because she had so little to give. Jesus calls his disciples and he said, "Did you see that? She has given in more than all things." Do you know that this woman, in giving so little, actually was used by God to raise more money for the Christian cause than any other person, as far as I can tell, in the Bible? When she gets to heaven, and Jesus is going around and giving everyone a crown, she's going to have the biggest crown of all. And she's going to look at Jesus and think, I thought they made no mistakes in this place. This is a mistake. That can't be true. And Jesus will say, no, this is true. This is what your little action, your influence has been in this world. So what do you think? Is it possible that you and I can say a word that will have a huge impact in the world and we know nothing about it? Of course it's possible. What do you know what God has used in your Christian experience? What do you know about yourself? If you happen to be discouraged because you think your life has not been worth a lot, you don't know. We know nothing by ourselves about ourselves. But if you go around boasting of your goodness and your prowess and your successes and your righteousness, then you show an absolute lack of understanding of the plan of salvation. This is not the people that God will save. You remember there's a parable in Luke chapter 18. There's two men, a Pharisee and a publican, right? And what does the publican have to say about himself? "I'm so glad I am not as other men are." He fasts twice in a week. How many of you fast twice in a week? Nobody. Wasn't he good? Yeah, well, he wasn't good at all. Really, he just didn't know. While the publican, who was bad, knew it, and that's exactly what Jesus was looking for. He was looking for someone who knew his condition so that he could come to his Lord with his need and have his need met. Amen. You know, we're not done. The 144,000, who are they? If you went, we won't take the time, but if you went to Revelation chapter 14, you would find that they are they who have the name of the Father written in their foreheads. Right? They have the character of God in their frontal lobe. They sing a new song, a song that's never been sung before. They are not corrupted with the falsehoods of other churches. They follow the Lamb whithersoever he goes. They have no guile in their mouth, and they stand faultless before the throne of God. These are the 144,000. Those are the people who are going to turn the world upside down. This is us, if the Lord should come while we're still alive. Right? So, the time of probation closes. The 144,000 find themselves on the saved side. Perfect. They'd rather die than sin. Right? What do you think they're thinking about themselves? Can I show you? Great Controversy, page 618 and 19. As they review the past, this is the 144,000 perfect people, their hopes sink. For in their whole lives, they can see little good. They are fully conscious of their weaknesses and of their unworthiness. Really? Amazing, isn't it? So if you ever get discouraged with your accomplishments or what you've done for the Lord, you have no grounds for it. This is just the way it is. Isaiah 49. And we're going to end with this. Isaiah 49. This is talking about Jesus. Now we're not going to take the time to make sure that I prove this is talking about Jesus. Study into it. You're going to find out that it is. It's referring to him. Jesus, chapter 49, we're looking at verse 4. Jesus speaking. Then I said, I have labored in vain. I have spent my strength for naught and in vain. Jesus. Verse 5. And now saith the Lord that formed me from the womb to be his servant, to bring Jacob again to him. Now, why did Jesus come? To save his people, right? To bring Jacob again to him. There's, he goes on to say, though Israel is not gathered, he failed. Yet shall I be glorious in the eyes of the Lord, and my God shall be my servant. Volume 6 of the Testimonies, 307. Christ was constantly confronted with apparent failure. He seemed to do little of the work which he longed to do in uplifting and saving. Even Jesus experienced this same thing. If anyone had known himself, he knew himself, right? He knew everything. And yet he looked at his life of service and he was discouraged because, actually he was never discouraged. But he was tempted to discourage him because he seemed to accomplish so little for what he came to do. But it wasn't true. Because he did all that his Father wanted him to do, however it appeared in his life. How does it appear in your life? And this is how we need to look at life. This is pages 679, talking about Jesus. He knew that the life of his trusting disciples would be like his. A series of uninterrupted victories, not seen to be such here, but recognized as such in the great hereafter. Amen. You and I can't know what's going on. You and I can't judge the effect of our work. We can't decide whether we've been successful or a terrible failure. We're too blind. Totally. But we have a God in heaven. If we have dedicated our lives to him, and to the best of our abilities, obey his words, accept his salvation, go forward doing all that we can, however it appears to us, the outcome is in his hand.
Amen.
And he can use this. Thank you. Shall we sing? Hymn number 99.